What's up guys, in today's video we're going to model this Hive controller, this virtual reality controller that you can see on the screen right now. Now this is going to use some more complex subdivision surface modeling techniques, and this is definitely not going to be a beginner's tutorial, and it's going to be a much longer tutorial. So if you're brand new to Blender, if this stuff is a little bit too advanced for you, then make sure you grab our hard surface accelerator program in the description below. That'll get you up to speed with hard surface modeling in full in under 2 weeks. So again, I'll link that program in the description, especially if you're a complete beginner. Without further ado, let's get started. So for a model like this, we pretty much have to use reference photos, unless you have like some crazy high IQ where you can just look at an image and just trace everything perfectly. Then, you know, more power to you. I'm not that smart. So we're going to be using reference photos here. And that's oftentimes why you'll see concept artists will have, you know, a sketch first, and then they'll translate that into 3D. This is a perfectly valid, you know, strategy, is tracing things from an image. There's nothing wrong with that. So what we're going to do here is we're just going to start with a plane, or rather, instead of a plane, let's start with a circle. Now, since we're going to have to use a sub-D workflow here, we're going to need to use a much lower resolution basically. So what I'm going to do is start with maybe, I don't know, 16 vertices, and we can always condense this down more if needed. So what I'm going to do is just move this circle up right around here. We're going to rotate this on the X. Let's move this up a little bit. I'm going to rotate this on the X, move it up on the Y, scale this down a bit. And we don't have to be perfect, okay? We just want this to kind of follow along, you know, close enough. So that's kind of the first thing I want to do there. Let me also rotate it so it's this way. I'm gonna kind of look in all different dimensions because it's gonna be angled down at a slant, kind of like that. And yeah, that should be fine. Cool. Now what I want to do is go into edit mode here. We're gonna take a vertex and we're gonna duplicate it. And we're just gonna kind of trace this out. And again, I'm going to be going quickly, so if this is too fast for you, you should grab the accelerator course, because that'll make sure, you know, everything's familiar to you. So we're going to go ahead and just kind of fill this all in. And then I'm going to be using Mesh Machine for the quick symmetry feature. So if I press Alt X, you can do like a quick symmetry basically to the other side. Then down here, I'm just going to go ahead and let's just leave it alone for right now. Cool, so now what we need to do is we need to start kind of joining these things up, all right? So this should be pretty easy. I'm gonna go in here, I'm gonna fill that. I'm gonna subdivide this edge. We're gonna fill that. And then I can just press F and then F again. I can also subdivide this, double tap G. And then I should be able to fill that like so. And then for this one, I'm just gonna go ahead and dissolve this vertex right here, okay? And then we should have a quad right here to fill in. And then I can just symmetrize that over to the other side. And again, we're not trying to trace this perfectly. We just wanna get close enough. Now, at this point, we can go ahead and just fill this. We'll subdivide this, maybe move this back a little bit, and then fill that, and then fill that. And then I'll just go in here and we'll just extrude this down and we'll just fill these edges as well. Just something very basic for right now, just a general trace, okay? Now you're gonna see right here, this circle isn't like a perfect circle anymore. We could fix that right now. We're gonna probably have to fix it multiple times if I do it now, but just to kind of show you, if you turn on the loop tools feature in the add-ons panel and just search for loop tools, right click, loop tools, and then circle. You can either use circle, or what might work better in this case is the relax feature. What this does is it distributes the vertices evenly. So I can press Shift R a few times to repeat that command. And you're gonna see, you know, versus what we have before, this is a lot more of a circle now. It does move some of these vertices, so keep that in mind, but overall, this is completely fine. There's no issues here. Now what we need to do is just kind of take a look at this. So you're gonna see this is looking a little bit strange. It's looking just incorrect. This is why we use multiple angles here. Now, what I would recommend doing, I recorded this tutorial once and I thought, you know, there's a much easier way than just like rotating this, you know, 90 degrees every single time and then moving it over. That's just kind of like, you know, a pain. So instead of doing that, what we can do is we can press Alt D. This will duplicate it, and any changes we make to one are gonna be adjusted to the other, which is great. So what I'm gonna do is, once again, Alt D, can rotate this 90 degrees, well, negative 90 degrees rather. Gonna move that right there, and then we're gonna Alt D this again, and then RY negative 90 to go upside down, okay? So now any changes I make, you know, are gonna be adjusted to all these, okay? Let's just move this up a little bit. So say I move this back area, you're gonna see all these other sides are gonna move as well. So this is gonna save us time, so we can just hop in and out to these different ones very, very quickly. So now what I need to do is look at the side view here. We just need to move these things into place. So I'm gonna take this edge of this little, I guess I'll call it a wing almost. We're gonna move that over here, and we're just gonna kind of move that into place, all right? Then I'm gonna take this edge and just move that over. And again, we're just kind of tracing this. This isn't anything complex. The only thing complex at this point should be the speed of my workflow. So that's what I'm saying. Like, if I'm going too quick, this might not be the best tutorial for you. And then for this one, I guess this edge right here, I don't know, just kind of move this into place, or at least take this vertex here, kind of move that into place. Can symmetrize that down, and already you're gonna see we're in a much better position compared to what we have before, as you can see. Cool, so now what we can do is just check here in the bottom view. Basically, if I just go into wireframe mode, I could just put these, you know, more or less in the right position. Again, we don't need to be perfect at this point, we just need to be good enough. And now what I can do is I can basically go in here, and I should be able to press the 4 key using machine tools. That doesn't always work. So what we could actually do is we could simply, I don't know, how about we go in here and just extrude this around more or less, okay? We can get this sorted here shortly, but for right now, I'm just gonna go ahead and just fill that. And I know this isn't perfectly matched in the location, but it's fine. Not really a big deal. And then just to kind of readjust the location of those areas, we're just gonna kind of move this back. Just symmetrize that over. And again, we kind of have like more or less a rough draft here. Then I can go here into this view, move this up a little bit. And then basically I can just go in and kind of just reposition these, you know, wherever they need to go. For example, that would go over here. I could kind of go over here. This one kind of go over here. Symmetrize that over. Cool, it's not perfect, but it doesn't need to be once again. And now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and let's search for rip vertex in the F3 menu. And what that's gonna do is just rip the vertex and split it into two. And what we're gonna do is move this back a little bit, move this back, and then I can fill this in so that way we actually have a quad there. We can kind of move this up. And once again, we can just use that really neat relax feature. Now we'll just go in here to loop tools, and then I'll go to relax. And I don't know why that's not working. And let's try using circle instead. Let's go in here to circle. Okay, that one seems to be working, all right. So let's go here to circle. I know I just said that like three times, and we're just gonna rotate this angle so it's not like twisted at all. All right, something like that should be cool. And this is looking pretty decent. And what I'm gonna do is just a final thing is I'm gonna put, maybe if my neighbor will stop screaming while I'm filming this tutorial. I swear, Americans, as an American, Americans have to be the most obnoxious groups of people on this planet. They're arrogant, they're loud. I mean, good Lord. And I say this as someone who's lived in the US my whole life. Anyways, I don't know why I'm bringing this up in a Blender tutorial, but probably some of you Europeans can probably relate for all the American tourists out there. Anyways, you can kind of see the result we have now. So now at this point, what we can do is just run a test sub D. And if we just shade this smooth, you're going to see we've pretty much got, the result we're going for, which is great. I guess the sub D doesn't carry over to these, which is kind of unfortunate. I thought the Alt D command would do that, but apparently not. But anyways, looks like we're in a pretty good spot here. Cool. I'm just going to quickly symmetrize this and turn off that remove redundant center. Let's dissolve that out. And I don't know what happened here. Must have done something by accident. Doesn't really matter. Let's just get in. Just kind of move that back where it needs to go. And let's take a look at this guy. Cool. This should be fine. All right. So far, so good. We basically have the rough silhouette here, which is great. And again, if you run the sub D, you're going to get a cool result. What we could even do here is use a solidify modifier just to kind of see how this will look in a more three-dimensional space. So far, so good. All right, now what we need to do is go here, and it looks like this is a little bit elevated, more or less. But first, before I do that, let me just kind of extrude this, fill this, symmetrize that over, just so we have that back area. Okay, and now what I want to do is I want to start creating this hole here in the top. All right, so what I'm going to do is I am basically going to take this outer area here. All right, and we're going to press E to extrude. Actually, before we do that, let's press F to fill, then it should extrude along those normals. So I'm just going to extrude that. I'm going to scale so we kind of have this 45 degree kind of like area on the inside there. All right, and we can kind of use this one for reference. Then I can extrude this back a little bit more until we have this bottom portion here. And I could scale, if I wanted to, I could kind of scale this up. Just kind of depends on the result that I want. Something kind of like that. And then what we can do is delete those faces. Move this a bit back on the local Z. Again, I'm using some rough sketches here. I'm not, using a sketch created by the designer with like perfect measurements, right? We're eyeballing this to a certain extent. It's a modeling tutorial. Then what I can do is shade this smooth, and we can just test how this is going to look with some proximity loops here. So I could go in, add one there, add some here. And add some here as well. And you kind of see what we have going on. So far, so good. And just test this one more time, just out of curiosity. And then one more time here, just out of curiosity, to see how that looks. All right, looks pretty decent. Cool. All right, so now what we need to do is take this area here. I'm going to remove the sub D, and we're just going to extrude this back this way. All right. And then I'm going to go over here. I'm going to take this portion, kind of move that over there. And something kind of like that. And then again, we can just go to this guy, symmetrize that over, keep that remove redundant center turned off. Now we kind of have this area. All right. Then we can just take a look at this portion, make sure again everything's lined up, which it looks like it is. Same for this side. And again, let's shade this flat and see everything a bit better. Cool. And eventually, what we're going to have to do here is turn this into a manifold object, meaning it's completely watertight and three-dimensional basically. Technically, this is three-dimensional, but it has no thickness to it. So we need to make it manifold to create that thickness, okay? So let's just kind of take a look at this. Now I already see some potential problems, and they're not huge problems, but they you'll see what I mean when we get to that point. For right now, what I want to do, just real quick, see if I can't smooth this area out a bit. It's probably not a huge issue, but maybe, you know, I could do circle. And let's just see what that did. Okay, that looks pretty good actually. And then what I could do is just move that so it's a little bit wider. So that circle just kind of made things a bit more even. And that symmetry kind of messed things up there, not a big deal. Cool, so now what I want to do is kind of start creating, you know, more or less a manifold type of object here. So I'm going to take these back edges and extrude this here, and then to here, and then to here. And again, I'm just kind of doing a rough draft. All right, and then what I want to do is go into wireframe. We're going to scale. Let's scale this area up first. And, you know, kind of scale this area up. Move that back. And just one more time for this underlying area. We can kind of scale that up. Cool, looks pretty good. And then same for this area. Let's go ahead and just scale that up as well. So we're slowly kind of creating a manifold object here, which is exactly what we want. I can press F. And what we're going to need here is to fill this. Press F again to fill that. And this is where it's going to get a little bit tricky to patch up. So what I want to do is the easy part first. There's no need to, you know, do the complex stuff first. So what I'm going to do is literally to start filling in the easy parts. This is just going to make life a lot easier. It's going to be less stressful. And we're going to kind of get the result that we want. So we can fill that. Looks good. We can fill that. And then we can fill these. And then this is where things are probably going to get a little bit messy. We're going to have to fill that one. And this is probably where we're going to need to kind of move, you know, some of these vertices around a little bit. I don't even know if I connected the right part here. Let me delete these. And just see real quick. Okay, before I do any of that, let's select this vertex. We'll press the F key and then press the F key here. And we're just going to kind of move these. And then we're going to fill this. All right. Kind of move that over here. This can kind of go over here. This can go over here. Again, we're more or less getting like a rough draft, I guess you could say. We'll take this one. Again, symmetrize that over. And as for down here, we'll fix that momentarily. This is where things are going to get a little bit tricky. Reason being is because we have a lot more vertices here than we have to connect up here. So technically, what I would need to do is add some additional loops, but this is going to cause issues. So what I'd actually like to do instead is condense this down to an even lower resolution. So I'm going to press Control X. And just slowly begin condensing this down. All right. We're going to get everything nice and even. Don't worry. But for right now, I just want this like way lower poly. And then what I can do here, I'm actually going to delete this inside portion. All right. Just go back to what we had before. And I'm just going to get this back into a circle, more or less. So let's try using the circle feature. And then we'll go to relax. And that relax feature is, something's off with it. Yeah, that's definitely not what I want. Let's try circle once again. Turn regular on. And then just change the angle. All right. And then for this outer portion, I probably don't need to mess with it too much, but actually, yeah, it looks fine on this outside portion. Cool. So let's go back in here and let's just do what we did before and basically get that back area extruded. So I'm going to fill this. I'm going to extrude this back. I'm going to kind of scale that and extrude it once more. This is already looking quite a bit better. Then I'm just going to scale that up a little bit. And once again, just trying to match it with a reference photo. Get in here and delete that. So now we have a much lower poly version. It should be easier to connect everything up now, hopefully. So let's give this a try. Let's see what we can do. Let's try filling that and then press F here. And then for this area, we'll just slowly fill that around. And then we just have to patch up this portion down here. So what I'm actually gonna do here is just press F to fill that. All right, and then we're gonna fill these. Okay, and then we're gonna fill these right here. And then at this point, we're just gonna need to add in a loop cut right here. We'll get that filled and then get that filled. Just symmetrize that over. And then let's just kind of take a look here, see if we can move anything around, if that even makes sense. Let's take a look here in the side view. Make sure everything's kind of following the curvature more or less. So for example, these vertices up here, we could kind of, actually technically we could just flatten this upper area, but I'm not gonna mess with that too much right now. And then I just need to get this, get these joined up here. And I could kind of move that up a little bit, kind of give it that grip. All right, so now this is actually connected, which is great. Cool, so we just condensed, what the hell is going on here? Let's see, something with that symmetrize. Again, you'll deal with this sometimes when you're using that symmetry tool. Let me just get in here and fix that. Gonna get in. Merge. Probably just get this cut out of the video if it makes sense, but I'll just do it real quick on video to show you. It's just an easy way to fix a problem like that. Cool. And then you can just press 3 with machine tools for good measure and make sure there's no like redundant geometry. And now we have something very low poly, very simple. And if we run a sub D, now we're kind of getting, you know, much closer to that final result there, which is great. All right, so what I'm gonna do now is just run a test sub D, and I think it's a good time to power save. So I'm gonna press Control 3 maybe. Right click to shade smooth. And let's just add in some proximity loops here just as a quick test. So we're gonna go in, gonna add in a loop there, add in some loops here, add in some loops here. Already it's looking great. And again, we're gonna undo this. I just wanna quickly see how this all looks when we have these loops added in, of course. Gonna add in some here. And actually, I don't even want to mess with the symmetry. It's just causing issues. And you're going to see this is how it looks when we add in all the proximity loops and things like that to kind of get, you know, this result. So it's looking good. We've pretty much followed the design, you know, as close as we're going to get without like perfect dimensions or stuff like that, without like a perfect drawing. What I might do is slide this out a little bit just so it's not so tight. Slide that in. And you kind of have a result like this, and this is looking really, really clean. Now, for some reason, the sub D doesn't run on these. I guess it doesn't carry over, but you can kind of see how this looks in all the different angles and directions, which is great. So again, that's just a quick test. We're gonna undo everything, and we're just gonna continue on with the workflow here. So at this point, I just wanna do like a final overview. I wanna make sure everything's lined up, you know, relatively nicely, I guess you could say. So we're just gonna get in, we're gonna take a look at everything. This one right here, what is this? So this vertex, like for example right there, you can see that lines up a lot better. So we're just gonna move that over. That's why we're using these different views so we can make sure everything is more or less in the correct position. Again, don't need to be perfect, but we wanna be close to it. Then we're just gonna go in here and join that back up. Make sure we have, you know, quads everywhere. And again, when you're using symmetry, you can turn off that remove redundant center, but sometimes, like I said, it causes like weird issues with the geometry, so just be careful there. So now what I wanna do is make sure everything is nice and even and consistent. When you're using sub D, you don't want things to be uneven. Like for example, here we have a really long quad. We want everything to be more or less even and consistent. So before we do this, just make sure there's not any like final adjustments you want to make. And if there are, it's not a big deal. You can always go back to an old save or do that later. But what I'm going to do here is just add in maybe three loops here will be fine. Put one here. And these don't have to be perfectly even, but I do want them to be pretty much even, if that makes sense. And then here, that's a bit too much, so we're just going to leave that alone. And again, doesn't have to be perfect, just get it as even as you can get it. Like the sub D is not going to be that big of a deal if it's not perfect. All right, so I'm happy with this result. Now what we can do is once again, you can run a power save just so you have like multiple backups. I always do this. Then what we can do at this point is figure out what else are we going to add here. Well, first of all, we have this button here in the center. This we're going to be using with the sub D workflow as well. However, for these smaller details, you could model these in, or you could just use a decal. If you were to use this in like as a game asset or something like that, especially as a render, modeling in these tiny details is just stupid. Every single game developer, anybody, you know, if this is were to be a game asset, are going to use decals for these tiny, you know, little tertiary details. That's just what happens in, you know, pretty much every game. They're not modeling in this tiny detail manually, and if they are, they're baking that detail. So for the tiny stuff, we're going to use decals. But for this big one right here, we're going to be using sub D still. Now this one's going to be tricky to add in because right now it's a little bit too low poly to get anything decent. Now I could technically go in here, you know, I could inset that, turn this into a circle, you know, turn off flatten, which isn't going to work well. It's just, this isn't ideal. What I'm going to do first is add in one level of sub D, okay? And as a matter of fact, what I'm going to do is shade this smooth, and I'm going to get all my proximity loops added in here. Okay, so we're going to get in, just get all these added. Let's just do it, go up to three for right now, just to see how this all looks. All right, going to add in the loop there. And then we're going to add in the loop. I'll just do a symmetry. Turn that off. And just join this up manually, I guess. It's fine. All right, cool. So now we have all the proximity loops added in that we want. Just going to make sure, am I missing any? I don't think so. This is following the reference pretty well. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to set this level to one. All right, and at this point, do another power save just to be safe. And if I apply this with one level, what is this? Make data single user, apply modify. Yeah, that's fine. We'll go ahead and click apply there. I'm just going to do it to all of these. Again, this is, I guess this doesn't carry over with the Alt D command. Doesn't matter though. So now what I have is a little bit more denser geometry here. So I can add in this circle. That's why I wanted to apply one level, but also power save so I have a backup in case I want to revert. Because applying that one level, you know, we can't really undo this, right? We can't go back to that low poly state unless we made a duplicate or have a previous save. So always make backup saves. I mean, hard drive space is so cheap nowadays. It's just dumb not to. What we're gonna do is go in here. This might be a bit too much of a selection, but let's give it a try. Let's go to circle. Let's I guess we can keep flatten turned on. Influence, keep that to 100. Just kind of play with some of these different settings. I don't really, whatever works well. We can kind of scale this in. All right, now in the reference photo, this is pretty much right near the edge, but if we do this with sub D, we're probably going to get some pinching. And this is why like a CAD software might be a bit better at tricky situations like that. But in this case, I could probably just get it close enough to the edge. Now what I'm going to do is just make sure this entire inner portion is selected. All right. What we're going to do is we're going to inset this. We're going to extrude down. And then we're just going to move this back. What that's going to do is create that little 45-degree curve right there that we can kind of see. That's pretty cool. Now it's not perfectly overlapping that, you know, area in the reference photo. If you wanted, if that was an issue to you, you could always expand the selection and, you know, kind of move this back a little bit. Just be careful. You know, if you go too crazy, then everything's going to be like uneven again, which is what I'm trying to avoid. And then we can just run a test sub D here. We're not making like any final changes, so let me just get all this selected. All right. And now what we can do is we can add in a test proximity loop here and then one down here. And look at that. Very, very clean. It's following this area nicely as well, which is great. I'm going to use this little button. We're just going to use like a cylinder or a decal or something. That should be totally fine. Now, as for the pinching on this outer area, it depends how much you want to worry about it. This could be a bit of an illusion with the matte cap. What I can actually do to inspect this a bit better is I can go in and you can see, like I said, with a sub D workflow, this area is kind of unavoidable. The closer this is to the edge, the more of a pinching effect we're going to get. We can just kind of see, you know, why that is a little bit tight in this area here. Is this something I'd stress about? Not particularly, but it's also not, you know, it's not the cleanest. Let's just take a look at like one more matte cap. So technically the shading's clean. It's just a little bit warped around here, but I don't think it's something worth stressing about. This is just kind of a limitation here of sub D. I could expand the selection, right? I could scale that in a bit. I could kind of rotate this just so it's less twisted. And that could kind of ease off on that pinching effect, right? You know, if I scale that in more, it's going to be even more pinched. It's kind of one of the limitations of sub D here and using like polygon-based modeling, basically. But just depends how much you want to stress over it. Once again, it's not something I'd really waste your time on, to be honest. Okay, but overall, we have this little detail right in here. Looks clean. We can probably use a decal for that little button. And how about the rest of the details? Well, most of them are going to be decals, but how about this little plated area we have here? Notice there's like a very clear, almost visual separation, right? This is very easy to add in, okay? So what I'm going to do here is, again, we can just increase the sub D level and just do like 2. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to alt click this. I'm going to press control B to add in a small bevel. E to extrude. Press escape and then alt S to scale that in. All right. And then what I can do here is maybe a little bit more, alt S. Let's take a look. You can kind of see what that's done. It's almost created like a natural plating effect. Now I think that should go deeper. Let's alt S and go maybe to that point. That should be a little bit better. Add in a loop there to tighten things up. Add in a loop here, tighten things up. Maybe it looks better without that. It kind of depends what you want. I think that looks pretty similar to what we have here in that reference photo. Maybe the bevel was even too large. If you know that's the case, you can always undo this. Make this bevel a little bit smaller. Do something like that, and now we kind of have like an even cleaner plating effect on the object. Now this one didn't carry over to here, unfortunately, and I think the reason for that is right when I applied the sub D before, it kind of made it its own unique user, so we're not sharing the data anymore, but that's fine. I can just go ahead and delete these for now, and we'll just do the same thing over here. Just bevel this one, alt S. Right, and then just add in maybe a loop there, then a loop here in the upper portion, just like that. And then we could duplicate these over if we want to use the side references again. And then if you want, you could, of course, you know, tighten this up even more. It just depends on, you know, how much of that plating effect you want going on. You can kind of see what that does by adding in those extra loops, right? But overall, this thing looks pretty clean. And I think this will be fine. This will suffice. You could always use like a slice operation with a boolean, but I think this looks significantly better and works well for the sub D. All right, so real quick, let's just go in here and duplicate this. And don't forget to use the Alt D command, very important. Just gonna move this back over. I don't even know if we'll need these references anymore, but you know, just in case. Move these back into place. And there we go. All right, so now what we're gonna do is we're going to move on to the materials and decals section of this video. So I think the modeling of this is essentially complete. I mean, we can do one more like final overview here. We do need to add in actually this trigger down here. That should be very easy. Let's do that real quick. I'm gonna go here into the bottom view. And basically what I can do is just take like this portion right here. It's kind of in the right location. I could actually relax this area. Maybe not. You know, if you want to follow the curvature nicely, you could move those vertices into place. So I can kind of move that up there. Just depends, you know, how much you want to follow the design. Symmetrize that over. Make sure that didn't cause any problems. And then we would just go in here, right? We would inset, maybe scale it up a bit and then inset that. We would extrude this. And then just like we have there in the reference photo, we would kind of scale this in, right? And now if we go in, we can add in a proximity loop there and then one up here. And then we kind of have a resemblance of that detail there in the bottom. Now it looks like it's a little bit larger. So I'm just gonna expand the selection, maybe scale that up a bit, which is totally fine. And then we have a pretty similar kind of result there, right? We're not gonna see too much because what we're gonna do is we're gonna add in this trigger. So we're gonna go into cube and you don't need to spend too much time on this area. You would just go in, kind of trace it out. Now take this edge, move that there. Now move that there. Just something kind of like that. Again, don't need to be perfect. Then we're just gonna take this piece, just run a simple, I don't know, sub D on it. And move this back, just run a sub D. Honestly, you could even half-ass this part and just use like a crease or something. Just depends what the result is you're going for. Let's go back in. So what I'll do here is just add in a loop there. Add in a loop down here. And I'm actually gonna just dissolve out this edge, it's fine. Then what I could do is just bevel that. You know, just kind of move that over and then just tighten this whole thing up. And then if you wanted to, you could add in a loop through there and then just kind of move, you know, this area back a bit. Just kind of like that. And then what I need to do is just rotate this 90 degrees. Negative 90. We're just going to move that over here. Just like that. Again, this isn't like a super significant piece you need to stress too much about. Then what I can do is just move this, duplicate this over, rotate that 90 degrees, and then duplicate it again, rotate that 90 degrees. And boom, there we go. Very simple. All right, now what we can do is we can go into material mode and we're just gonna start with the decals and the materials, okay? And actually, instead of material mode, I'm gonna just use cycles. I think it's gonna look better. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to add in an HGRI. You can do that manually with something from polyhaven.com. There's HGRIs on there. Or if you're a MaterialWorks owner, which is our plugin for materials, you could just turn on the HGRI that way. Then what we're going to do here is just add in like a uniform material. And it looks like to me this is some sort of plastic. So I'm just going to find some sort of plastic material here we can use. And these are all customizable. Let's try maybe this matte screen plastic. That one's pretty good. We also have this rough plastic. Just trying to see which one matches this the best. Industrial plastic. This one looks pretty good. And then we have this half matte plastic. It's a bit too shiny. And then ultra rough plastic, which is probably too rough. Let's go with this one. This is a nice mixture of reflective and kind of a matte. I think that looks good. And also it reflects the lighting very nicely. Now again, we have a bit of a different material on this handle versus the top part. We can add that in here shortly. But for right now, let's just get the basics done here, okay? Let me just run a power save. So we have the material. Now what we need to do is focus on the decals, all right? So what I'm gonna do is press, I'm just gonna use decal machine for this. And we're just gonna find something that kind of resembles the decals here. Now, if you don't have MaterialWorks and you don't have any of our decal packs, MaterialWorks inherits the decal texture now, or rather the decals inherit the texture. If you want to just pick up MaterialWorks and our decal pack in one go for a steep discount, there's an option on the MaterialWorks page for that. And again, that'll be linked in the description. So I'm just going to pick from one of our decals here. Let's try this one. Looks pretty similar. We're just going to move that in. And let's just kind of do this here real quick. Okay, once that's sitting in more or less the right location, what we can do is we can project that decal. And as you can see, it actually inherits the texture around it, which is great. So we're going to do that. I can also hold shift to slightly adjust that. That's great. And then we're going to add in one more. Let's go in. Let's add in another one down here. I think this one's actually a power button. And if I'm not mistaken, we have one of those here in the decal pack. I just need to find it. I know it's somewhere, but I actually found a cool one that could work pretty well. Could use that one, or we could use something that kind of looks more like a button. Let me just go back to this one real quick. It was in here somewhere. I just had it. Here it is. This one right here. This one looks more like a button. I'm just gonna get in. This one's a little bit larger, I think. Then we're just gonna project that onto the object. Looks very good. This one might be a little bit too large, but we can always, you know, readjust that later. All right, so we have a decal right there. And that one, I don't really like. I'm just gonna use, you know, maybe this one here. We'll move that right on top. I'm gonna project that. Great, and then we have some sort of logo right here. Now, obviously, I'm not taking their official logo, but I could use one of our info decals here. And we have plenty of info decals in the pack. Pretty much anything you can choose from. You know, I could go in and maybe use this one. Just put that back here somewhere, you know, more or less where this is. And then project that. Super simple to do. And then we have some decals kind of around these areas here. This is pretty self-explanatory. I'm just going to speed up this part where I add the decals right around here. All right, it took me a while to find the decals that I liked, but I think these will suffice. These will get the job done, very similar to what we have here in the reference photo. And then just as like one final decal, I think instead of using a physical decal, I'll actually just use like a cylinder. We'll just give this, I guess 32 segments is fine. And I'm literally just going to put a cylinder like right inside here. We can bevel it. This will just be like a separate piece. So I can literally go in here and just bevel it. Let me remove the smooth, whatever this is. There we go. And then I could just give it the same exact material here and just make sure that scale is applied. And if that doesn't work, let me just remove it and then apply that manually here. I'll just switch that to the UV settings and just do a quick smart UV project. That's fine. And there we go. That's pretty much close enough to what we have here on the inside. Just move that down a bit. Looks great. Now, as for the separate texture down here, one final thing I'm gonna do, and I'm actually just gonna delete these other ones here because we're basically done. Can hide this as well. Actually, I'm gonna need that for a second. What I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna go in, make sure the scene's saved. I'm gonna add in a cube, scale this cube up, and we're just gonna add in a slice operation right here, just like we have in the reference photo. So now if I go in, you're gonna see it's a little bit of a mess. So the first thing I wanna do is let's just shade this auto smooth. And you're gonna see we don't have a bevel right here. Well, fortunately, with the Material Works, we have a bevel shader option. You just turn that on and that's gonna add it. And you can make this smaller. We could go like 0.005 to make the bevel very, very tiny. That is a procedural bevel, by the way. So you can kind of see the difference. That's with zero. That's just a very tiny bevel. You could go larger, but it'll eventually just look fake. So you don't want to do that. So we have that, and we can just go ahead and hide that. Cool. And then all I want to do at this point is just give this a different little bit of different color, okay? Doing this a bit the slow way, but I mean, this is a slice. I don't even need to select over here in this area because of the slice operation. What I can do now is I can basically just assign like, you know, a new material here if I wanted to. So I could go in, I could give this like a second industrial plastic. Then I would just assign that. And then what I could do here is I could actually go into the color option and just change the color on that ever so slightly, then we're just gonna have a little bit of a different kind of result there. So what I can do is turn this back on. You're gonna see we have a bit of silver down there on the bottom, just like we have here in that reference photo. And then finally, it looks like I also need some sort of decal here in the side. And I'm pretty sure, like this power button here, I'm pretty sure we have one of those. I just don't remember which path. Here it is. Perfect. Just gonna get in there. And again, I could probably just eyeball this one. Project that. There you go, you kind of get the idea. All right, so that's a simple and easy way to model one of these virtual reality controllers. Very simple, very straightforward. You use some decals at the end, use some of the right materials, some good lighting, and you know, you're gonna have a pretty good result kind of like this. So. And the rendering process is pretty simple. At this point, you should know from my other tutorials. If you're not familiar with rendering, that's also shown in the Accelerator course. I'm not gonna go into that right now, but render is very simple. You would just add in a plane, get a basic composition set up, and you would be good to go. All right, so that's it for this video. Hope you enjoyed it, hope you learned something. Again, SubD is not really that complex once you actually know what you're doing and you know kind of how to approach it correctly. And again, if you're brand new to hard surface modeling, make sure you check out our Hard Surface Accelerator program in the description below. It'll teach you everything from the basics of modeling, design, presentation, and pretty much get you up to speed with hard surface modeling in Blender incredibly quickly. Thanks a bunch for watching. All resources will be linked in the description below, and I'll see you in the next video.